Hello everyone, this is Mirzai from Cal Poly Pomona, and in this lesson we're going to continue sensitivity analysis of a linear programming problem. In the series of video related to the sensitivity analysis, we are in part 2 where we investigate change 2, changing the objective function coefficient of a basic variable. Let's investigate change 2, changing the objective function coefficient of a basic variable, using an example. Suppose you have an optimization problem as shown on the screen and its associated optimal table. Also, in the right-hand side, you see the matrix of the formulas related to the optimal table given the basic variables of the problem. If you are not familiar with this matrix, please refer to the part 1 of the sensitivity analysis in simplex matrix math video. In this example, suppose due to a saturation of the market, the first product profit has decreased to $30. What is your recommendation to managers? So in this case, we're talking about the profit of a product. So when we talk about profit or cost, we typically referring to objective function coefficients of decision variables. So when we referring to the first product, we're talking about X1, and we're talking about changing the profit from $60 to $30. So basically the objective function coefficient of X1 has changed from 60 to 30, and we want to know how this optimal solution is going to change with this change in the profit. We have the set of basic variables here, and we know that X1 is a basic variable. Now, if you're changing the objective function coefficient of a basic variable, basically we are changing our matrix CB. If I look at the given matrix of the equations, I see CB appears in this equation as well as this one. So I expect to see some changes in the objective function coefficient of non-basic variables in the row of Z as well as my objective function. So the best practice is to see in what range our coefficient here in the row of Z remain positive. Because if you remember, for the maximization, we said we are remaining in the optimal table when all the coefficient in the row of Z are positive or zero. So I want to add a delta term to that 60, to that coefficient here, 60, and realize to up to what range this optimality condition remains. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to recalculate the CBB inverse AJ minus CJ because I'm changing the coefficient of a basic variable. So this is a matrix CB that we previously introduced, but instead of 60, I put 60 plus delta. In this vector, we followed the same order as we had in the simplex table. So the first coefficient is related to the coefficient of S1 in the objective function, which is 0. X3 has 20 in the objective function. So X3 coefficient is 20 and X1 coefficient is 60, but instead of 60, I put 60 plus delta. So that's the vector of CB. I multiply CB by B inverse AJ. If you remember from your table, B inverse AJ is given under non-basic variable in your final table. So I put my non-basic variable and their coefficient for B inverse AJ. And then minus CJ, the CJ, whatever order you put in your CJ should be consistent with this order that you have. And then put the coefficient of non-basic variable in the objective function. X2 has a coefficient of 30, and S2 and S3, they don't appear in the objective function, and therefore their coefficients are 0. So if I solve this equation, I have to solve parametrically because delta is a parameter that will appear in my results. So this is the vector that you get. And remember, these are the coefficient of a non-basic variable in the row of Z for X2, S2, and S3. Now I have to enforce these coefficients to be positive to find a range of change for which we are staying in the same optimal table. Because if any of these become negative, then we have to continue the table by finding the most negative value in the row of Z, implementing the minimum test, and so forth. So I enforce each of these term to be a positive term and find a range of delta for them. Now the final range of delta will be the intersection of all of these areas. So I kind of draw a graph here that shows delta and draw the line for each of those region, and the intersection here falls between -4 and 20. So between -4 and 20 It's the intersection of all these three ranges that I found from here. So for this range, I remain within the optimal table. But how much we are changing? So remember, the question asks us, what if the 60 drops to 30? So we are looking at the delta of negative 30. Before we go there, I know that the mu c is equal to 60 plus delta. And therefore, from this equation, delta is equal to c nu minus 60. Now, if I replace delta in my range, I can find a range for the coefficient instead of the range for the delta. So you see that if your coefficient is between 56 to 80, you're remaining in the same optimal solution. But in this case, your C is equal to 30. So 30 doesn't fall within this region. Or in other sense, you can say your 60 drops to 30. So you have a negative 30 as your delta. And negative 30 doesn't fall within the range of delta that you're given here from negative 4 and 20. So what happens? So basically, C1 has changed to 30, which is outside of the allowable range. So the current optimal table is not optimal anymore. We have to continue the table to find a new optimal answer. So how do we do that? Remember, this was the final table that we were given. With adding delta, so this is the new coefficient for the rho of z for non-basic variables. So we went from 60 to 30, so our delta is negative 30. I replace delta into this terms and find a new coefficient for the rho of z. If I do that, make this replacement, putting delta as negative 30, these are the new values that I get for my non-basic variables. Also, I have to update my objective function. My objective function coefficient 60 now is 30. Now, if I calculate the new objective function, I get 220. So if I replace the objective function as well as the new row of z instead of the older one, I have to implement a simplex table because I have some negatives. I have to find the most negative value in the row of z. Then I have to implement a minimum test and find the entering and exiting decision variables this way and do the iteration. I don't explain the details of it because I expect by far you know how to implement the simplex table. So if I do the iteration using elementary row operation, this is the new table that I get. Now in this table, still I have a negative term, so I have to continue the table. I take it to the next slide so you can see what happens. So I find the most negative value here and implement the minimum test, go to the next table and do the elementary row operation to make x2 a basic variable instead of s3. If I implement this elementary row operation, you see that now we are in the optimal table because there is no negative term in the row of z, and therefore we have reached the optimal solution. So the final objective function value is 272 as opposed to 280 that we originally had. We kind of expected it that because our profit has decreased. But see what happened. By decreasing the coefficient of x1, meaning that by decreasing the profit from x1, we kicked x1 out of the basis. So we are no longer manufacturing x1. And instead of that, we are producing x2. So you see, since the profit of x1 has dropped by $30, the optimization suggests stopping its production. Instead, it suggests starting the production of x2. So your new solution now is x1 equal to 0. X2 is 8/5 and X3 is 56/5. And your slack variables are 136/5 and the other two slack variables are 0. So with this, our lesson regarding the sensitivity analysis changing the objective function coefficient of a basic variable has concluded. Please refer to your Blackboard for your assignment and thank you for watching this video.